Yeah, it was one because myself and my wife, we run a comedy night down here, and there was a real feeling of not wanting to come down and say, oh no, no, this is the way it should be done. You know, we're from London, and it's really easy to kind of be patronising to a town that you think's a bit behind the times. And they, in terms of putting on events and comedy, there were a bit, because there wasn't a comedy night. So we used our contacts and now built it up, and it's a fantastic night. We do it once a month. We don't take any money for it. It all goes back into the club and back to pay the comedians. And, you know, it's full every month. We compare it together. And it feels like a really, you know, it feels there are real regulars coming. But because when my wife and I present it, we compare it. It's like sitting in our kitchen because we're bickering and kind of chatting to each other. And that works really well. And then, you know, apart from that, we're doing a lot of music as well. And I've got, you know, friends that are in bands here and... and then, like, doing the charity show last year at the White Box. So, yeah, it's really important to do that, I think. Great if you got out of the France.
I played lots of instruments, and I was, you know, bizarrely, I really loved school because of all the extracurricular stuff. So I loved all the music stuff. I loved the drama stuff. I was doing comedy at school, and... So all of that meant, and I had a really good group of friends. We were quite naughty as well, but not really bad. But enough to kind of be a gang and enjoy getting together and kind of we all helped each other through those few years, which could have been really, really tough. And I knew I'd just scrape past. I got minimum, I mean, then it was O-level, so I got minimum passes on 8 of them. But I didn't get anything else. You know, there was no distinction in any area, even music I just scraped through. And then A-levels, which they just took me back to do A-levels, they said, that was tough, really tough, really tough. But because I wanted to do drama at college, I got a minimum offer of 2 E's, of just 2 passes. So I thought, well, that's it. I'm certainly going to get that. I mean, and I just got that as well. No, not at all. Because I like, as I say, I quite like the safety of it, and I quite like being a big fish in quite a little pond. And so the college I went to, when I went to college, it wasn't a university then. It's a university now, like everywhere's a university now. But they, because it was a drama school, and it was mainly a teacher training college, but with this amazing drama faculty. But there were only like a handful of students, so it was great. So once again, we arrived there, and I went with my best friend from school. And within, half a year, we were running the drama stuff, the radio, the TV station, the magazine, which was just fantastic. I mean, and it afforded me that luxury of being able to do that, which, you know, ordinarily, I'd have got lost in it. I think, I've always liked smaller things rather than big things. Even venues and playing venues. My favourite venues are always smaller venues, just because it's, you know your audience, you know, it's intimate and it makes it a bit special.
So was it easy to achieve? Did you find yourself being more successful at college than you were at school? Was it easy to achieve once you got
exams? Once again, academically, no. It was pretty crap again. Really, I mean, I got a 2-2, which is a middling degree. And thank God there was a lot of practical stuff. There was a lot of kind of filmmaking stuff. We were allowed to go out with video cameras. I mean, this is in the 80s and make documentaries. And I was always looking for an easy way out. And actually, my regret was that I didn't make better stuff and make use of the facilities better. But it was just an extraordinary amount of fun, you know. And where I was at college, Winchester, which is a small town, was kind of quite like this as well. There's a lot of underlying weirdness. So because I'm a London boy, it was it was nice to get out. And that's how I feel about being here. I had a really happy teenage time. Although I went to an all-boys school, which was a bit miserable. So I was a bit of a late developer in terms of relationships. Which, let me tell you, going to an all-boys school is not a good idea. I think it can be very, very... Did you go to one? No. Yeah, and you meet these... Then you go to college and you meet these people who go, yeah, I had sex when I was 11. You know, and it was encouraged at our school, and you know, you're going, please let it happen soon. That was quite frustrating. Very frustrating. Well, because I'd always known that was what I wanted to do, to go into comedy in some way. I didn't want to be a stand-up comedian, but um, I my first job after college, I was kind of, because it was a drama and telly degree, I started, there was a station, BSB, which was like the Sky rival in the early days. They had square reels instead of the round dishes. And they had a music channel that was opening, which was to rival MTV. And so I wrote in and I got a job on that. And it was unbelievable, the people there, Joe Wiley, Chris Evans, Suggs, Boy George. It was everyone's first TV job, doing kind of presenting work and stuff. And I was a writer. I spent a very unhappy year with Chris Evans. He was a really, really difficult man to work for then. That was before he was famous. And then we all got made redundant with the company, because they decided not to have a music station anymore. And I thought, oh, what am I going to do? So I decided to run a magazine. We started to run a comedy magazine, which we ran for over a year. And, you know, with no money, and we were drawing dole at the time. And it was, so that was a pretty tough year, but it was fantastic. Once again, I got to meet lots of comedians and get to know that world and write about comedy, which I knew a lot about. And met someone who pushed me into doing stand-up, who was at that time was Eddie Izzard's manager, and Eddie was just becoming quite well known, and that's how I got into it. I started doing stand-up and did that for about 3 years, and decided, nah, I've had enough of that, and then went into character comedy, and running clubs. I ran lots of nightclubs, and I ran a board games nightclub called the Double Six Club. We just came in and played board games, and we played Easy Listening, and that was really successful, and toured around the country. We released an album, and so it was, you know, I've done a lot of weird stuff that was all, you know, my 20s. I wasn't really earning a lot of money, but it was a fantastic experience. And it was when you could just kind of do stuff, and that's how I feel about this place, is that you can kind of just, if you have an idea, just put it on, people will come to it, and, you know, test and see whether it works or not. Now, unfortunately, in London you can't do it, because the stakes are so high, and it costs so much to hire a venue and do the publicity, and there's a million things going on. You know, back then in the early mid 90s, it was a little bit easier.
Do you also enjoy getting into characters?
I just love characters, and again, that's why Hastings is so great. There's a lot of inspiration down here, a lot of strange people. But I do. I love, and I'm always writing down ideas for characters. And it's funny, because I worked with Matt and Dave for so many years before Little Britain. We all started together. It was, you know, it's that desire to kind of what people watch and take on board weird mannerisms and stuff. So, but I enjoy writing now as well. I enjoy doing other things. Yeah, fishing. Love fishing. It's one of my mainly deep sea. Marlin, Barracuda, whatever.
I was like you were saying about Little Britain. You worked with some of the top, cream of UK comedy.
Yeah.
You also with Hollywood stars.
Yeah.
Do you sort of enjoy? Massive.
Well, it's weird. It's strange, because in comedy, because you know, there's a different level of success. Matt and Dave are multimillionaires, and obviously I'm very happy they are. But you know, because you do start with people, and they are mates. It's very different, because it's just like going to, it's just like turning up for any kind of work with your mates and just having a laugh. Or Rob Brydon or whatever. I mean, we're all good friends, so you don't feel like you're working with stars, except sometimes you get photographers in trees, or it's a bit strange. But the Hollywood thing's amazing, because it's doing those ads. So I've done about 16 of them now. That's the most fascinating, because you're looking. You're getting a snapshot into their world and the weirdness of, you know, when we got it, the last one that will come out this year, which will probably be the last one we ever do, is the one with Val Kilmer. And they were saying, well, it could be good Val or bad Val. And it was good Val on the day. But, you know, the fact everyone's on tenterhooks wondering whether this big star's going to be a nightmare or not. And there are a few that have been quite difficult to work with. Daryl Hannah. Yeah, it's funny. But I have to say, there aren't many, many, many nightmare stories. You know, most people are quite... You do hear stories, but, they, you know, people are usually quite lovely.
Yeah.
Yeah.